Who's this? This is our people behind the scenes.
What's up, dude? Come on. New York, put it on the floor.
New York, put it on the floor. Rolling.
Right, now it's time for a little attitude.
This is the scene where Christina jumps out of the airplane and...
He's a dork.
It's a coming-of-age story about a young man who's trying to find himself.
That should be young girls who are way too attractive to be 17.
That one up there, Will.
I will not be attending this movie myself.
Alvin is missing something. He's been in high school, been getting straight A's, you know, working on engines and cars.
You're one of the three finalists, Alvin. You're the man.
Really intelligent, but he's never really had fun and really hasn't enjoyed the high school life. He's never had a date.
Remon.
Paris slightly notices him because he's her pool cleaner.
You know, I've been looking all over for you.
He fixes my pool.
I clean it, I don't
he's
fix it.
He's a pool boy.
I'm more like a pool doctor, you know what I mean? A poolologist.
You know, he comes every week, cleans her pool, he's good at it.
Nothing sexier than a pool man.
The elite students are at a pool party. We're having a great time. Alvin shows up to clean the pool and then...
Paris Morgan is the popular girl of every school.
She's like a frappuccino with hips.
She's got money, she's got style, she's got tons of friends. She's kind of like the it girl.
Look at me.
And she's the girl that Alvin is admiring throughout the whole movie, and a couple other guys too.
She's like unattainable. She's like the Ark of the Covenant, but a girl. You could kind of meld those together.
Paris is one of the elite girls. Alvin is one of the dorks.
Alvin, did you twist your ankle or something?
Nah, I'm just walking.
Give everyone a chance to envy.
Look out!
He finds out that she is in desperate need of some help with her car that she wrecked.
Do you have any idea how much that's gonna cost?
$3,000?
Alvin knows a lot about cars.
And Alvin comes in to save the day.
I can have it done by Monday.
He bribes me to go out with him, and this is what starts up the whole movie. I'll fix your mom's car if you go out with me for 2 weeks.
And don't even look at my booty.
Right, right. No booty licking. I mean looking.
I don't know how you came up with this idea, Alvin.
I'm a genius.
I consider it like a Cinderella story because it's a boy who was a geek and he turns cool.
Because in high school, who you hang out with gives you a certain respect at school.
She hooks him up, gives him a makeover. Everybody else likes him too. He becomes popular.
Oh, no. Let me do that for you.
It kind of gets to his head because people are starting to feel him. He's showing up at school and parties. They loving him.
Dang, look at you.
Pimp parade.
Of course, in the end, she finds herself starting to like Alvin.
I was thinking that maybe we should still hang out sometime, you know, as friends.
You're a great listener.
Huh?
He went from damn to damn.
By the time Paris really starts digging him, he's over her, and he's ready to be this Mr. Cool dude.
Al, I need to talk to you.
Don't you see grown men are talking here? Bounce! Giddy up!
Did you just see how he just dogged Paris?
Mm-hmm. Look at him, standing there looking better than a butter leather Prada bag.
A grinder is a group of people that are always grinding something. They're either grinding books, they're grinding the engine of a car. Whatever it is, they exhaust all possibilities. They're like extremists.
We're kind of the, I don't know, outcast of the group. I'm really one of his nerdy friends that gets left behind and...
Alvin!
Alvin!
However, he tries to reject his grinder statusness ship.
You gonna party, go put on your good stuff.
I don't have any good stuff.
We're not nerds, per se, but we're kind of the outcasts, a little socially inept, not real good with the ladies.
Hi, Paris.
Hi, Paris. Hi, Paris.
We're the nice guy who's always really awkward in front of women.
Chuck, have some coof.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it's just breast and bottoms. Damn.
You got this group of like grinders, and we're the elite crew, so we're always like messing with them and doing things.
Yo, check this out, right? Losers sit over there to the left. You feel me?
But I bump into the jocks, and then we have words. Well, they really had words with me. I didn't really get to say much.
They torture us, push us around, and make us feel stupid. We're not even allowed to go in their hallway.
I was doing some stunts. I mean, I got a knot on my elbow. You know what I'm saying? I got some bruises.
But we wish we could be them. It's that kind of self-loathing that lives at the core of every nerd.
Jones, assist Sanders.
Sit down, Q-tip.
And that's real life. That's really how it is. You know, just like there's a scene in the movie where all the grinders are just looking down the elite hallway, hoping that one day they can walk that hallway.
We're about to graduate soon. We have no memories. I mean, we're settling. And they're not.
That's kind of like the difference between a grinder and an elite.
The elites are the elites. They're just snobs because they can be.
Popular. Everybody likes you. Everywhere you go, you got nothing but love.
There's a whole group. She's got her girlfriends, which are Yvonne and Zoe, which are very bougie, you know. One is kind of more of a follower. The other one's a little bit more ghetto.
Yvonne is ghetto fabulous.
Tell her what Yvonne
Don't
said.
Don't hate me because you ain't me.
She's this far away from an attitude at all times.
She's all about, why go for a snack when you can get a meal?
You're taking me to Jerry's Friday night, right?
How could I say no?
He just broke up with Paris less than 24 hours ago.
I'm just mad I hate you too.
Zoe's like the follower.
My homie.
So she's really there for me, but at the same time, doesn't know whether to follow me or Yvonne.
We're great friends in a sort of catty, backstabby, I want your man kind of way.
Yeah, those are my girlfriends. They're not really good friends.
Hello? What happened to the pact that we wouldn't date each other's ex-boyfriends?
This ain't Burger King. You can't always have it your way.
Clarence Johnson is stuck in the 70s. Clarence used to be quite the ladies' man, so to speak. You know, varsity, basketball, football, letterman, ladies' man, had it all working. Clarence never really been there for Alvin much, you know, but he sees this moment where Alvin is trying to change and he decides to get involved in his boy's life.
All that working like that, without no loving, that drive man crazy.
The dad's got this idea of what his 18-year-old, like, high school son would be, because he was the popular guy in high school.
He sees an opportunity to turn Alvin into a ladies' man. That was his thing. He wants it to be his son's thing.
Oh, pops, moms, what's the deal?
That one up there.
Of course, his father is very happy because the whole movie is trying to get him. He wants him to score with a girl. And of course, I love my little geeky son just the way he is.
Let me go in here and say something to this boy.
And when Alvin finally does have a date, Alvin's dad tries to block us from entering the room.
Now Alvin dating a girl now. He don't need to be hanging around y'all scientific-looking ass no more.
There's a banter that goes back and forth that's been happening for years, like, Alvin, your loser friends are here. Why don't you guys go out and meet girls?
And your dad's funny.
And his character is just like, I just want my son to have one good experience, at least, in high school.
Just let the boy have some fun.
Mr. Johnson is very excited that Alvin is preparing for his first sexual experience.
I'm about to give you my number one smooth groove jam, guaranteed to set the mood just like you need it.
Bit too enthusiastic.
You can run, but you can't hide. That's why they call you Johnson.
Rolling.
You must do that.
Nick Cannon was the first choice just right away. He's just got this charisma about him.
I think he's a talented young cat, man. I'm being a stand-up, and he's a young stand-up, and he has much respect for me, and it's working out just great.
Yeah.
Nick Cannon is one of the most talented young actors that our company has worked with.
Producer, we gonna put it down, see? Go ahead, hit it.
Nick will be a very big star in the future because of his comedic talent, dramatic ability, combining that with his musical skills.
Cultural phenomenon is what we create, right?
That's right.
By himself, this cat is immensely talented. He will be a big star, believe me.
He's just delicious. He's, you know, you really get that this kid is a star.
Yeah.
He is, he just oozes stardom.
And he just gorgeous. He's gonna be a movie star.
You know, my first scene was actually with Nick, and he made me feel really comfortable, and we had just had a great time.
We then became familiar with Christina Milian.
Cheese.
We had a lot of confidence in the two of them together.
Christina Milian.
She's a lot prettier than I am.
Working with Miss Christina Milian, whew, let me tell you.
That's the money shot right there.
Give him a nice little lap. Let's practice.
Great.
I think it makes all the difference, the chemistry that you have with somebody.
Beat him up.
You could put two actors together and have chemistry and really make a really great movie.
I love him.
10 million, 20 million.
Yeah! I've had leading ladies, and no offense to all the other leading ladies that I had, but I'd have to say this is probably the most eloquent, elegant, all the Ella words. She's that.
See, that's the beauty, soft like.
Now
see
we
that?
Can finally she, be hired.
She usually don't look like that.
Shut up.
The moment she walked in the office, we were all sitting around this oval table, and Christina walks in, and she sort of sits there, and it's like, I couldn't even breathe. I was like, oh my God, that's her.
What's up, guys? Paris Morgan.
You would think somebody like that beautiful and stuff would be like kind of snobbish and stuck up.
Just kidding.
But she just kicks it, hangs out, burps, like acts silly.
I feel like a dork. Excuse me.
Is that our song?
Sound like it to me.
Steve is a fool, but we've always wanted to work together, and now we're actually doing something together, and he's just a fool.
I've always wanted to work with Steve Harvey, and then it was just perfect comedic timing, like bouncing off each other. It was like a well-oiled engine. We were just working.
That's what I'm talking about, boy.
Steve is just naturally very funny, so he has us rolling. We've just been cracking up nonstop.
That was probably the most fun I had on a set when Steve Harvey was around.
There ain't a woman born that can resist the motion, bam, of the ocean, bam. I'm in the joke-telling business, and that's what I'm doing this movie right here, you know? And they let me ad-lib and do my thing, and there's been some great stuff coming out of here, you know?
I've done about 5-6 stand-up acts in between setups, you know? A new theme, new subject every day, just new stand-up acts.
I was so distraught. He was so difficult to work with. So I'm gonna do my thing. I'm gonna be funny. I'm not Denzel. I'm not Marlon Brando. I got it. Gracious God.
Yo, what's up? I'm Nick Cannon, and you're watching BET. Black Star Power, for real.
I love Troy, actually. I wish I could do like every movie with Troy because she's been so much fun.
No question.
And from the beginning, even before we started the film, she allowed us to be so free with the script, with our characters.
It's part of the job.
Troy Byer, she's an actor's director.
Benefits.
Because a person who knows how to act, who's been acting before.
I love the way you did that.
They bring something else to the project that just a director couldn't bring.
That's just marvelous.
Because they know what they want exactly.
That's perfect right there. Okay, good, that's a shot.
And they can show you how they want it, and they also have been in my shoes before.
She's done this before.
Action!
I can't imagine what it would be like to direct a film without any acting experience. Because I so often just tapped into my resources of being an actress.
I need actors to direct.
When we were rehearsing, sometimes she'll just have us improv a whole scene. And she'll be like, take away all the lines. You know what the scene is about. Just do it.
And then you can punch him if you want, okay? No, I'm just joking.
It's a career break for her. There are very few African-American directors in Los Angeles, and she's probably one of the few that really want to tell commercial, straightforward stories.
Very good.
With her, it's not about color whatsoever. It's about, are we making people laugh, and are we telling the story?
And action.
What I like the most about directing a film I've written is that I am really there, and it's my vision, for sure. It's really exciting.
Oh my God.
Background action!
The teenager's greatest fear
is public humiliation. That's why the agenda to be cool and to try to appear cool and that you have it all together is so important. That's why clothes are so important.
Don't get me wrong, man. I'm Murphy Lee, ain't dumb, man. I say, give me two birds. I need two birds.
So I can get the stomping in my Earth Force One.
Big boys stomping in my Earth Force One.
Urkel has gone gangster.
The clothes in the movie are so hot. Paris has got to be hot. She's wearing the Juicy. She's got the hot outfit, the Gucci, the Prada. They got it all going on.
Girls talking in the bedroom in bathing suits. They don't invite me to the set on those days.
Alvin's not really up with the hip hop, you know. He's not really like wearing all the Sean John and all the designer labels.
Wearing my helmet. It's off the hook, right?
Well, these nerds can't even afford those clothes.
Hey, look here, look, see. Why are you hating? Why are you hating?
They even go to the extent of ordering labels and sewing fake labels in it, you know, to be accepted.
I got on high fashion just like them. Would you check this out?
Yeah, a fake label you got off the internet and stuck on some Wranglers. Very high fashion.
It's like most people when you're in high school, if you're caught up into to that sort of thing, being cool is the most important thing.
And if you wear enough designer clothes, then people would think you're cool, even though inside you may be a nervous, insecure wreck.
It's more representative of the world for many, many kids today.
A lot of people probably already feel like they know this story or they know what's gonna happen. We put a couple of little things in there for y'all. A lot of comedic twists more than anything. Things that you wouldn't really expect to happen and the comedy comes out of nowhere. But you weren't expecting it and it happened. This movie is definitely a comedy.
Boy's gonna hurt himself.
And it definitely has a love story in it, but it also does have a few messages.
It's good. Piece of heart in the story, you know.
Alvin, look, man. When I was in school, I was one of the coolest dudes at the school. But I'm gonna tell you something, though. I have always, always been proud of you, son.
I think this is a great movie on a lot of different levels because so much yucky stuff happens to people when they're in high school. Like, you know, the cliques are so stupid, but we've all been in some clique, whether we want it to be in it or, you know, we're sort of labeled that way.
And I think the ultimate message or the ultimate theme is just to be yourself.
Accepting your place in school and just being comfortable with it.
It gives people a chance to look at themselves and say, okay, well, maybe I'm an Yvonne and I need to stop being that way.
Educational.
Once you get underneath the surface and you see what your cool cheerleader is really underneath that cheerleading costume, and you see what our geeky guy was really not so geeky underneath, and really they actually have very similar values.
Alvin ultimately has a chance to get Paris at the end of the movie because he becomes comfortable with himself.
Yeah. To be cool or to be in and all that other kind of stuff isn't really what it's about. It's about being yourself. And ultimately, that's the coolest thing is when you are yourself and you're happy with yourself and you're content with who you are.
This is me.
Alvin Johnson.
Pool boy. This is me. I ain't afraid to admit it.
Head cut.
It's all good, though.
Hey, guys, what's up? It's Christina Milian right here on BET. There's a lot of great different types of sounds and songs throughout the soundtrack of this film.
We're here in Norfolk, Virginia, shooting an amazing video for the soundtrack of Love Don't Cost a Thing. It's called Shorty Put It on the Floor. It features myself, Chingy, Busta Rhymes, and Fat Joe.
My peoples, you heard?
There really isn't any other group of artists right now that's coming together and working in such an abundance.
And it's going great so far, you know what I'm saying? I'm feeling it. And I think y'all gonna be feeling the video too.
We have some of my pals, Nicole and Melissa. Come on, come into this shot so you guys see.
Hey, ladies.
Not only do you have like beautiful like stewardesses and stuff too, then you got superstar beautiful women that are coming be in the video too.
Hey,
see, it's just amazing. The concept is way crazy. It's pretty much that I got my private jet. Jumbo jet. You should see how huge this jet is.
The plane is incredible. I ain't flying 10 years. That might be the one plane to get me up on the air, you know what I mean?
And I'm trying to throw a party with all my homeboys.
Good silverware, you see. That's that real good stuff. It don't bend or break.
We trying to include everybody and just have a big party. It's kind of like it's the rap party on the plane.
It's neat to be able to tie in the movie along with, you know, the music and stuff, so.
And me, I pretty much heard Busta Rhymes was gonna be here, so I said, okay.
It's a lot of hard work, long hours, but I think it's gonna pay off. It's gonna be out. That's a wrap.
This one here is called Love Me Baby, featuring Jazzy Faye and Sleepy Brown.
I'm basically playing Murphy Lee's girl. There's scenes where I'm walking through the hallway, doing some usual school things, so I think it goes well with the movie.
You can stay in school, though, that's what's up. Well, yes, you can stay in your mama's basement forever.
The song is about Murphy Lee saying, I'm gonna get you to love me. And you know, I send you flowers, I think that you're fine, I think you're this and that. The chorus and the title speaks for itself.
Just teaching women, you know, you gotta love yourself before you love somebody else. Putting good words in my women's ears.
Kissing, hugging, and kissing, kissing and hugging. Give me a chance.